Now, let's quickly move on to the next very interesting panel discussion that we are having. As they say, while smartphones and gadgets rely heavily on what two websites, Amazon and Flipkart, to push sales on the e-commerce sites, and they are usually multi-branded, and they can't really favor one particular brand over the other. I don't really know if that is happening. If that is happening, we'll just keep that for later. However, let's talk about how brands can ensure that they are leading the e-commerce market and also making themselves, what's the keyword of the day? Future-proof. To discuss more on the topic, acing the online shopping research, experience to boost brand silence, we have a fantastic panel with us today. First up, let's welcome our session chair, Nitin Mathur, co-founder and CEO of 91 Mobiles. Hi, Nitin, how you doing?
Hi, very well. Thanks for having me.
Glad that you are here. And a panel of experts, we have Prashant Jain, Director, HP India Marketing. Hi, Prashant, how are you doing?
Hi, very well. How are you?
I'm good, thank you. We have Roshni Das, Marketing Director, Intel India. Hi, Roshni. I think I'm seeing you after a very, very long time. I've done a lot of mall events for you in Bangalore and in India.
Good to see you, Vaibhav, and good to be here.
I'm glad. Thank you so much. We have Suraj Balakrishnan, Head Marketing India and Bangladesh, Acer, and Utsav, CEO of Noice.
Everyone, Maestro.
Yes, I hope everyone is here. So I'm just going to leave this to Nitin, over to you. And please remember, anybody who's watching this, the hashtag is PitchCMO. Please go ahead, share your thoughts, and put up all your questions on the Q&A tab. Over to Nitin. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Vaibhav. So let me just start by setting a bit of context. So I obviously lead 91 Mobiles, which is a gadget site. We help people who are looking to buy any consumer electronic product and researching, finding the right choice across categories like mobiles, laptops, wearable, audio, even appliances. So next to Flipkart and Amazon, we probably have the most data on in-market buyers and what they actually do in their research journey. Now, across categories, our user surveys show us that, where do people, what source do people use to make their, which as their primary source of decision-making when they're shopping? I think about 25-odd% of the people use the e-commerce sites as their primary source, not just to buy, but even to, decide what they're going to buy. 15-20% use sites like ours, 91 Mobiles, as well as other gadget sites, review sites. 15-20% use YouTube, and a similar number prefer to go offline. A similar number just talk to references to make up their minds of what they're going to buy. Now, in most categories, survey after survey tells us that people take 2 to 3 weeks on an average to make their purchase decision to decide what to buy. So the question here is, what can a brand do in this period to build salience for their products? In a context where so much of eventual purchases have now moved to the large e-commerce sites and are not happening in the brand's own stores, whether online or offline, particularly offline as it used to be, right? So in this context, let's delve into the strategies of some of the top consumer electronics brands in India. Today, I'll start with Prashant Jain, who's Director Marketing for HP in India. Prashant, just pulling you in here. So laptops are obviously a very highly considered purchase. People take a few weeks to decide before they land up on an online store. What is your strategy during this research phase? Please give us an overview and kick off the discussion.
Sure. So I did a couple of things. I think a few things which have changed. First of all, over, say, the last 14 odd months, we are definitely seeing a say a you know a shrinking of the entire shopping life cycle. So it used to be 3 weeks, 3.5 weeks. Given that the PCs become so essential to your working from home or learning from home or playing from home, people are actually closing their research within less than 10 days, right? So that's one change, and therefore the challenge which you kind of mentioned has probably become even more acute, that you've got to influence that purchase in a very, very short kind of time frame, right? And And that's therefore, I mean, made us pivot a bit, right? So instead of really trying to, you know, influence that person in those 10, 12 days, what we've realized is that the primary job of the brand is to be in consideration when the shopper comes into the market, not after she's entered the market and has already started her research, right? And therefore, the mainstay of our content strategy really is to start with the content which the customer wants, not only the content which we want to put out about our products, right? So, for example, when it comes to gaming, we do a lot of content which is basically about how to be better at gaming, right? And not necessarily about what's the best gaming laptop to buy. So through the Omen Squad, we just have, you know, tried to become relevant with a lot more mainstream gamers, gaming enthusiasts, even gaming pros, and make sure we serve that content so that the brand is in consideration. And obviously then the customer comes in and starts, you know, doing her specific product-led purchase where, you know, e-commerce sites, platforms like yours become a lot more relevant, right? So I think that's one. The other thing which we've kind of focused on is to really answer specific questions which customers are asking. So we've built capability over the past 8 months now to know what our customers are asking about our products or about our categories. So whether it's platforms like Quora, or you know, or just e-commerce, where a lot of Q&A is today happening, where customers are asking you very specific questions about very specific products, right? And you just need to be there, have digital capability to read that question, and then to answer it in real time. It solves it not only for that customer, but for a lot of customers who are just relying on these platforms for their research. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, thanks. I think that makes a lot of sense, being where the customer is rather than trying to drive them to somewhere that they aren't, right? So that does make a lot of sense. I'd like to bring in Suraj here. Suraj, you know, how similar, dissimilar is this? Anything you do differently? What's your take on the overall strategy that you go?
Well, I echo a lot of things what Prashant has said. I agree with a lot of things, you know, which he has touched upon. I think what I would like to add is the offline piece to this whole journey, because customer wants to even go to a store, experience a product, see what it looks, touch and feel, experience of that. I think that's also something which also influences the online sale and vice versa. So the whole journey, like Prashant said, is shortened because of the pandemic. So it's more of a quicker decision and they want it immediately. And this also influences the delivery also influences their purchase timelines, right? So for example, if you get delivered in the next day, then you have a better chance of converting a user, especially from online side. So I think we are looking at options, even like endless aisle models where, you know, customer can go to a store, experience a product, but get it delivered to his home through the online platform the next day itself. So it's all about omnichannel experience, and that's how, you know, we would like to see a customer. Customer can buy from anywhere, but he would like to get a unified brand experience. I think that's what we are all moving into. And traditional brands like us, who have been in the industry for what, 22 years here in India, I think the D2C is something which something which really exploded in the past 14 months. And that's something which, you know, we have really scaled up, and I think we are reaping the benefits because we are also able to control the experience of what a customer sees on our product. Right? If you depend on a Flipkart or Amazon, we are kind of hamstrung with their templates and all of that. So I think overall, I think both are important, D2C from our side and the marketplaces. But I think more importantly, the unified experience trumps, you know, all of these. So yeah, I think that's what we focus on.
Right. Thanks. I think definitely. I think you know, getting more deeper into content marketing, omni-channel, as well as the role that, you know, own brand store plays in all of this. I'll come to that in subsequent questions so that we can do a deeper dive. But bringing in Roshni over here, Roshni, your perspective to this is different, right? So Intel powers laptops. Doesn't sell directly to customers, yet is a massive, massive brand. So as an ingredient brand, you know, what's your goal in terms of driving consideration, not just for your own brand, but possibly for the category as well? What is your approach there?
Yeah, I think that for us, we, like you said, we are an ingredient brand, and our role primarily is to kind of uplift the category relevance, expand the PC goodness, you know, propagate why PC technology is important in people's lives. Similar to Prashant, but what we do is, of course, we do it cross ecosystem and cross partners. The interesting piece is, I think both Prashant and Suraj talked about it, right? It's decades and weeks. So what we've seen in terms of shopper behavior is, across our proprietary research, is that most consumers would look at least six touch points, you know, and we've seen social, search, definitely tech sites like yours go up, and then manufacturer websites, e-com, and then of course friends and family continue to stay as word of mouth. So these are pieces, and therefore I think it's begun to define how we are addressing these customers. I think both Prashant and Suraj talked about being where the customers are. One of the pegs that we add additionally is that we also go to social platforms that are emerging. For instance, we do work, say, with ShareChat, right? Tier two, tier three. Interestingly, three out of five customers today buying PCs are coming out of smaller towns. So what Intel does as a brand is therefore then integrates into platforms that cater to tier two, tier three conversations, right? Or interestingly, brands like Array, right? Not heard of much, but great formats, very intuitive, great conversations. So we, you know, we extend what our partners do. At the same time, we grow category. And I think since we have you here, Nitin, definitely want to say that, you know, we do take a lot of partnerships. We do put a lot of partnership focus in terms of, you know, tech sites like yours, where obviously, we are seeing a lot of review content, influencer content getting integrated into gadget sites, and that kind of focus on understanding a little more on what is, you know, underneath the hood has made the consumer more savvy. So our job is to kind of demystify what is underneath the hood and be in all these places.
Right. Thanks. I think some of those are interesting points. I'll call upon you to maybe talk in more detail later on, you know, what exactly you're doing with some of these platforms. For now, I'll bring in Utsav, who is the COO of Noyz. So Utsav, I think a slightly different twist to the same question for you, because Noyz was a D2C brand far before the term D2C was in vogue, right? You started with your own site, built your business there, then moved on to marketplaces. Even now, I think your site accounts for a fairly significant share of sales. And yet, obviously, the marketplaces are still, you know, dominant and account for a majority. So how have these dynamics changed, you know, in your experience? And if you could shed some light on Noyz's strategy on, you know, how you go about, you know, building the brand salience, and also how you maintain your dominance in what's a fairly competitive market, right, when it comes to audio products in particular.
Sure, Nathan. So it is very different for us in terms of the sheer indulgence that you see across the two categories in our portfolio. Whilst audio ends up being extremely impulse driven, where there is a presence of people buying multiple devices given the use case, some of which in a way kind of emerged during lockdown, people suddenly started realizing the need for truly wireless devices, where the wires were too much to tackle and they were just extended hours. You wanted lighter weight. People suddenly started working out a lot more, and hence newer use cases emerged. People wanted great call quality, which from a very layman perspective seems like a very easy, taken for granted solution, but required noise cancellation because you're working in closer proximity to other people around and you wanted to cut that out. So for us, that was a category where whilst there is a huge degree of impulse that drives, when it comes to smartwatches, it's a different animal altogether, because you actually do have customers going through those five or six touch points like Roshni was mentioning, where they want to compare, they want to understand what the battery life is, they want to understand what the features look like. But more importantly, I think it's the UI UX that people need to familiarize themselves with. So there is a huge degree of word of mouth. There is a huge degree of comparisons and reviews that come into play. So for us, the constant innovation and keeping a pulse on the consumer has allowed us that perspective. And we are a very, so to say, young brand, unlike some of my peers here, where for us, whilst it may seem very rudimentary, some of those consumer connect strategies have helped. Because we had D2C in our DNA, we till date actually read a huge degree of data that flows to us directly from the consumer with our own website, but also engage in things like weekly focus groups, which Zoom has enabled and made life a lot simpler for us on, to really understand the dynamics that need to be brought out in product innovation.
Right. Thanks. Yeah, I think TWS definitely as a category has shot up like anything in the last few months. But could you also sort of kick off, you know, the discussion? I wanted to go a little bit deeper into, the D2C route, the own store. And obviously, I think as a percentage of sales amongst all the panelists here, you would probably be doing as a percentage the most. What is this broad split like? And how do the two things go together, right? Your store and the marketplaces.
Sure. Nitin, I think for us, our own store started from 100% kind of a share of voice, and till date contributes to almost a fraction of our total business. And that's a number that we control because you could kind of amp it up over time. But the reality is that there is a very clear challenge that D2C brands need to overcome, which is essentially the marrying of the where and the who. And in our case, especially when you talk about customers who are shopping, and you were right in mentioning that they're beginning to use the marketplaces as search engines trying to figure out the product. For us, I think that clear divide of who we are speaking to, whether it's a tier three customer, and in our case, that's almost a 35% contributor today. Or you're speaking to somebody who's well aware, well researched, knows exactly what they want to do, the divide becomes clearer. There is a second lens that we end up using, which is essentially the lens of whether it's a category buyer or a brand buyer. And I think that becomes essential for us to be able to distinguish our efforts on whether it's a consumer who's likely to buy the brand and hence transact over our own platform, or it's a buyer who was looking at features at a certain price and ends up drawing comparisons with other products, end up seeing reviews, and then transacts over a marketplace.
Right. Makes sense. I think, you know, we see that division as well, where people who are who started their purchase journey, like either fit into, and it depends from category to category, a certain percentage would be the category shoppers, where they'd be searching either by price or by feature, and there would be certain who would be leading by brand. Certain percentage obviously would be your own and then other competitor brands. And obviously there are different marketing strategies you can have to for the different cohorts. But I'd like to bring in first Suraj and then Prashant's experience as well here. Specifically, Suraj, in terms of the brand store, just to understand, what role does it play? Is sales on brand store or on your own online store a big goal? Is it going to increase, or does it play more of a role in terms of salience building, where eventual sales happen elsewhere? How do you look at that in your strategy, Suraj?
Yeah, sure. See, if you look at the overall sales, the percentage, it's compared to other channels, the brand store won't be big, right? But what we measure is just not on sales. We measure also on the customer engagement, what we get out of our brand store. So we look at how many people actually probably create an account in our brand store and then finally ended up purchasing and registered with us, right? So that kind of gives an idea how much of influence we had as a brand store, even though the purchase happened in some other partner store or a marketplace store. So yes, you're right. It's not only about sales. It's about building salience. It's about building an experience. It's about getting products first to market. So when you have your own brand store, you don't need to depend on a marketplace to have a product listed on this on their site. We can get first to market many of our products. So it's about being first, but more about building salience. So overall, it's a mix of both, but sales is not the only objective.
Right. Yeah, I think makes sense. I think closing the loop in terms of getting people back to register their warranty, etc., probably an important source of getting some at least interface and knowing who your customers are. Prashant, what's your take on this? The brand store, what role it plays in the
order? Yeah. No, so see two things. We along with PCs are also in the printers category, right? So printers, supplies, and obviously services. I think, when we look at our data, and that was really the genesis of, having an own store, there are several customers who are looking for an additional source of trust, right? And especially when it comes to consumables, for example, customers want to shop from the brand store, right? So I think this incremental trust and servicing that need of trust, servicing that need of knowing that I'm dealing directly with the brand without an intermediary is it's a need with a section of the customers which you have to fulfill. I think that's one. The other thing is what Suraj said. I mean, beyond a point, you have to control experience, right? And eventually, wherever the customer buys from, you have to ensure that she's getting a great customer experience, right? In our store, we are able to do that a lot more. Not to say that, for example, the Amazon and Flipkart experience is something which is inspiring today, right? In terms of, time of delivery, accuracy of delivery, post purchase service, they are doing an outstanding job. And we probably have, something to learn from there as well. However, in many other terms, in terms of, say, providing, value-added services, we can provide a much larger gamut, being specialists when it comes to, PCs and printers, which probably multi-brand sites and multi-category sites will take some time to reach, right? And therefore, from that perspective of providing post-sale experience plus, value-added services, and obviously a brand controlled experience, a direct relationship with the customer, the store has its own, kind of pride of place.
Right. Yeah. I think value added services, definitely, something that grows the interface of the buyer with the brand, quite essential. I'll, at this point, try to, go to Roshni, and I think obviously for Intel, the brand side would be a lot more about content, I'm guessing. So, let's go a little bit deeper into what, all the brands on the panel here today on content marketing. So Roshni, I'll just preface by saying that, for people from my generation, the Intel Inside campaign was, an iconic one. And there are people of a whole generation who would, never buy a laptop that's not powered by an Intel processor. Now, today, fast forward to today, the content strategy would be a lot more, evolved even since then with, the new platforms, gadget sites, but also the newer platforms. So could you talk us through what are some of the things you're doing, not just on sites like 91 Mobiles and others, but also on the newer age platforms?
Yeah, thank you. I think that, yes, you're dealing with a more digitally savvy consumer. And I think all of us have reiterated that. For us, I think when we look at new products, what we do tend to do is at least because when we launch new products, the consumer wants to understand a little more, so then we use our brand site. But otherwise, our position is that we don't want to interrupt and we want to hasten the consumer's journey as quick as possible, right? So most of the time, our campaigns land on e-com because if the person is already in the active shopping stage, then you'd rather serve him or her what they're looking for, right? So that is really the principle that we operate on as an ecosystem player in the category of PCs. But having said that, there is a whole category of people, 40% of people that are researching before they land on e-com, right? I mean, I'll give you a few statistics. We have a really strong social listening hub out of Singapore. And we've noticed a couple of things, right? Even if you look at your own research, Nitin, 91 Mobile said that the number of YouTube reviewers or just reviewers have grown 5x, right? Some 500 reviews to 2,500, correct the number if I'm wrong. And if you look at our social listening, we've noticed that the number of authors that are writing about tech have gone up 4 times, right? And therefore the engagement also has gone up. So a lot of our work therefore is to intersperse with these tech reviewers, with these unboxers, with these influencers to tell our story and demystify. We do see processors as one of the critical components because PC performance has become so critical, right? Work from home, little bit of lag, frustrations, both for us, our children, et cetera. So PC performance is something that we do focus on. So one part of it is, like I said, being there where people want to understand and demystify this category. I already talked about some of the newer pieces we're doing. The other thing that we are also exploring and we see is that while Prashant talked about streaming, we did partner with one of the newer streaming TOs, tournament organizers, Irony, on Valorant, 30 hours of streaming. Now, why are brands doing streaming, right? I mean, yes, of course, this engagement, this conversation on YouTube. But if you look at the China model, about 10% of people streaming then buy, right? So they get like 9 to 10% of their commerce out of live streaming, and that's where we're headed. So this the engagement prefaces eventually, hopefully, a choice of the brand. And then I already talked about shoppable form. I mean, I didn't talk about it, but I wanted to bring up things like shoppable formats as well, right? We are very big on visual imagery, but also shoppable ads. So then once we do work on, say, Instagram using latest formats, we ensure that there is clickability, like I said, so that shoppable commerce is happening through visual mediums as well as bringing us the consumer to the point of choices. So a ton of things, I think even Utsav talked about it. And then if we have a little time, we can talk about some of the strategies that we have, you know, addressing the lower tier markets a little later. But yeah, exciting times. And digitally savvy customers keep us on our toes. So we have to ensure that we're giving them what they want to know to make better choices.
Yeah, thanks. I think you were referring to the Laptop Buyer Insight survey we did a few months back. It's quite interesting that I think when one of the questions was, what is the reason you would buy a laptop, or what purpose would you buy a laptop for? And I think the vast majority was for work or for study. Only I think 5-7% of the people said for gaming. But when we asked what is the most important attribute about the laptop, how do you decide which one to buy? Performance is by far the number one attribute. And you know, you could argue that it's more important for gamers, which is a smaller subset, at least in terms of numbers, but it seems to be what sells the laptops. And a couple of other questions I think was people said that, you know, on an average between the time they start researching, they'd read on an average 2 to 4 reviews, whether videos or text or whatever, and you know, in that process. And I think it's a good example of both the art and the science of marketing, where you know, you're obviously exploring the newer platforms, and the science, you know, which is where we align with brands, is also to help people reach the people who are in the buying journey 3 to 4 times during when you know the time they're consuming that content. Like to go to Prashant. You know, taking a deeper dive into content marketing. I think there are a couple of very interesting things that HP is doing for the gamer and the creator communities. Could you, you know, talk us through exactly what that is and, you know, how that fits into your strategy?
Oh, sure. I would love to. I'd love to talk about, first of all, the creators community. Absolutely exciting times to be working with creators. We recently, started our journey of, creating a community for creators. We call it the HP Creators Garage. So what we've really done is that we've been researching what do creators actually need, coming back to that first point of, you know, content always being customer centric. What we really learned was that a lot of casual creators are coming into the market, right? And what they are really on is a journey to become creative pros. And they are looking for allies in that journey where, a lot of them are looking for mentorship. They are looking for how to, including how to, say, edit my videos, how to get more followers on YouTube and so on, right? So we've tried to, be an ally in that journey. with the Creators Garage. We've brought together, 17 of the, the top creators, podcasters, graphic designers, YouTubers of the country, and almost put together 500 hours of content, which, is organized into playlists. So it helps you a casual creator to really, fast track his learning curve and just become better at, what is his side hustle today, right? So that's one. And we really believe that, these are the ways brands can partner with customers. It's honestly not so much about engagement, but again, being fiercely customer-centric and delivering the content what she needs. I believe that if you deliver that content, she will remember you at the right time. She will see you as a brand, which can be a partner in her journey. I would also want to talk about another, initiative which is doing very well for us, which is centered around learners. So again, the big insight was that if you look at early years learners, right, kids from ages 3 to 7, they are the ones who've struggled the most when it comes to learning, right? Because it's very difficult for them to engage with audiovisual media alone. They are designed or they are used to learning from all the 5 senses. And therefore, last year, September, we launched a Print Learn Center. Basically, what we've done is that we've worked with top educators, early years educators of the country to put together content which helps early years learners acquire the top 5, top 6 skills which they need, which are age appropriate, through worksheets, right? Which therefore do not involve staring at the screen, but rather involve taking up a pen and paper and learning through them, right? And so I believe this is, for example, an example of a content marketing initiative, you might call it that, which is so closely connected to the printers category, right? Because, it enables the use of the printer, makes the printer more relevant, but at the same time solves for a really core customer need. Now, we've honestly not cared about the fact whether she has a HP printer or not, right? And probably that's the first consideration you have to throw out of the window. We've just today made it open for anybody and everybody. If she has a competition printer, I'm fine. Right, as long as it meets her needs today and helps the child continue her learning journey even when the school is closed. So yeah, I mean, those are the two initiatives which have really kind of given us a lot of satisfaction. Half a million people are already now they've subscribed to the Print Learn Center. That number is increasing so fast that we really believe that it's probably giving us a lot of bang for our buck.
Thanks. As someone who runs a content site, I always find it exciting to hear about examples like these. I remember a time when, maybe 5-7 years back, marketers used to ask, content is fine, like in conversion, kaise hogi? And, we've definitely come a long way since then. Suraj, your thoughts on content marketing, what do you guys exactly do? And maybe you could throw some light on your influencer strategy as part of content marketing as well.
Yeah, sure. I mean, like Prashant and Rosh touched upon, right? I mean, influencers are a community which nobody can ignore these days. I think the kind of influence they have on a purchase is quite huge. But what's more interesting is, I think, the regional influencers who are coming up. I think there are a lot of regional influencers who are coming up in their own local languages, who drive a lot of influence for purchase. So when we look at, say, an Onam sale, we work with a lot of influencers in Kerala, or specific to Durga Puja, we work with Bengali influencers. So it's just not a national influencer which we're talking about, but more about going deeper regional. I think Rosh also touched upon in terms of number of sales coming from smaller towns. And these are influencers who are on not just on YouTube. I mean, they are on channels like Tuck and new platforms which are coming up. Instagram Reels is really huge. Instagram is pushing out a lot of these video content organically. So I think it's just not on YouTube. I think the platforms what they are present are huge. And this is a community which we work very closely, both at a national and at the regional level. So in terms of content, that's quite huge. We also have a platform called Planet Nine, which is probably one of the leading gaming platform where you have coaches on the platform who coaches the people who want to take gaming as a career. They can host gaming tournaments on that platform. You can be a teacher and get earn money on that. So we have also built up a kind of an influencer platform for gamers called Planet Nine. So it's all about bringing the community together. I mean, as a brand which has been here for so many years, I mean, the awareness is not probably the issue. It's about how do we work along the community and ensure that we are part of their journey, like Prashant mentioned. And that's where we really get long-term association with our customers. And that's what we aim to. So all of this plays a huge part. I think the traditional way of marketing is not the success these days. I think these are the kind of initiatives like which Prashant touched upon also, which HP does a lot of great work as well. I think that's the kind of way we look at in terms of, especially the new age communities like creators, right? I mean, they're not transactional. They want to stick to a brand and they would like to associate with a brand which stands for their journey and how we can develop them to grow. So yeah, I think some new exciting stuff which we do, and it's all a learning and all this new digital age which we are living in.
Yeah. Thanks. I think regional influencers is interesting. You mentioned that it's definitely a big trend. We did this talent hunt contest recently to surface and promote budding influencers in the tech space. I think 30 to 40% of the entries were in languages other than Hindi and English. And I think Roshni mentioned the statistics about, I think, influencers rising from 500 to 2500. If you count micro influencers, including people in regional languages, I think it's impossible to keep track of. There's just, so many new people coming on a month-on-month basis. We'll pull in quickly. I think we just have 5-7 minutes before we'll have to take questions. So I'll quickly pull in Utsav here. Utsav, tell us your take on content marketing. And I think a small twist from your perspective is that, your products are, I think, tech and lifestyle in equal measure. So, how do you sort of define them? How do you straddle this this positioning when it comes to your marketing strategy?
So Nitin, actually, you bring about a very interesting perspective here, which is that when you talk about accessories that aid connected lifestyle, people are now using TWS devices for as long as about 10 to 12 hours. Smartwatches are on people's wrists for as long as 24 hours. I mean, they are just taking it off to charge once every 10 days. But when you talk about the take on influencers here, for us, the bucket is divided. There are influencers and like Prashant and Suraj have mentioned, where there is a certain shift towards the micro influencers coming out of the tier twos and the tier threes for sure. For us, a lot of influencers do active work in terms of the post-purchase because we are a product category where the purchase doesn't end with just the hardware. 50% of the experience or more is the experience on the app in terms of when somebody's using the smartwatch. So we get a lot of these content creators who are actively sharing content on the app in terms of workouts, guided workouts, helping you into fitness regimens, giving you yoga and wellness sessions. So that becomes a huge volume for us in terms of keeping our consumer engaged. And when you look at that, that's a large part of the brand experience that gets delivered that otherwise on the surface doesn't seem to exist. So for us, that's a very, very interesting space. And when you talk about the lifestyle aspect of it, I think the most interesting bit is that compared to most typical tech influencers who are drawing comparisons and talking about features, you end up seeing a lot of content with regards to product placements that end up happening because there are content creators who inadvertently as a part of their lifestyle end up using the device all day long. So that keeps giving about a huge use case perspective to our users. And I think that helps further the brand message to a large extent.
Right. Thanks. So I think we just have time for one question and maybe a minute to each of the panelists. There are two, three themes that are still left to explore. So I'll sort of combine them into one question and maybe give a minute to everybody. And I'll phrase it as asking, you know, what are the some of the trends that you see coming up in the next few years? You know, one of the themes we had to explore was, is there, you know, a disruption in the market coming by virtue of, you know, Chinese brands launching in each of your categories, like we've seen in smartphones and some of those brands now expanding into other categories. Another possible future trend is, you know, how omnichannel and your offline is going to be more tightly integrated with, you know, with the overall experience. So this or any other trends, maybe, you know, just a quick minute from everybody. Roshni, would you like to kick this one off?
Yeah, I think a couple of trends, right? One is marketing. One is just ecosystem collaboration. I think definitely you already touched upon omnichannel. What I would say is that definitely the interoperability is what we're going to see more, right? And since this topic was about e-com, we're going to see digital journeys. We're definitely seeing a lot of digitization and then store creation. And then obviously, wallet integration. So what really this gets to over time is that you're going to see between e-com and fintech, you know, richer profiles of people, right? So, and therefore also better credit worthiness over time. I mean, look at how big the debit card industry today is, 850 million. Look at how much digital payments is today, 300 million. So you've seen like a whole class of digital buyers come in. And you've seen a whole class of shoppers come in. So what that means is obviously between fintech and e-com, you're going to get richer profiles, to target. I think the second piece is just the fact that if a consumer can look at six touch points and has therefore six areas to also go explore, I feel the democracy of choice will widen. So it's great, right? Dispersion of choice happens, you know, so they may want to buy on .com, they may want to buy on a physical store, they may buy on e-com. So I think it's great for the consumer. And I think the third piece is really more from skilling, right? I think at least from us, and I think Prashant talked about it a little bit, is future readiness, you know, for people that are coming in. Yes, we have influencers, creators, but there are a lot of new skills because of digitization that a lot of our consumers have acquired. For instance, AI, crypto, data sciences, so much out there. So I think that as a technology category, we have to be ready to enable some of those. So, you know, for instance, we launched something called Future Bana Wonderful, which is giving away 80 hours of a data sciences course free, which is on AI, you know, completely free. And we are cross-collaborating with our partners here, as well as with the e-com people also of the world, that if you register, you'll get courses free. So a lot of interesting pieces, right? Omnichannel, future skilling. Of course, you already have some of the marketing areas, which is, like I said, skilling on AI or just voice and vernacular as part of our campaign. So
Right. Looking
forward to watching this and doing more.
Thanks. Suraj, your thoughts on top trends? Quick minute.
Yeah, I'll keep it short. See, I think I'll touch upon the omnichannel piece of it. See, what we as a brand we do is that, you know, we don't want our own brand store competing with our own retail store, right? I think that's where we need to be sure about how do we ensure that the brand store actually helps also the retail store as well and not compete against each other. So we work on models where, you know, if you even if the order comes on the store on the online store, the fulfillment can happen at the retail store if the pin code is nearest to one of our exclusive partner stores, or the vice versa. If the partner store is not carrying a particular stock, they can still, you know, get it built through the online store and delivered to the customer the very next day. So the fact is that omnichannel also should help the customer as well as a large partner community, and that's what we as a brand look forward to, and that's what we have built a system as well. So I think omnichannel experience is something which will grow, and that's a trend which we will keep seeing more and more brands ensuring that they invest a lot of money and resources to ensure that that infrastructure is built up to serve the next generation of customers.
Right. Yeah, truly omnichannel experience would definitely be very, very interesting to see. Utsav, a quick minute from you, and then I think Prashant can conclude for us. Utsav?
So, Nitin, I think in addition to what Roshni and Suraj have mentioned, I think one large trend that will come about is with regards to hyper-personalization, because whether we like it or not, there is enough and more data, at least data that we've managed to get out of our own research, where over 50% consumers are expecting a personalized offer in the 24 hours of them engaging with you. But I'm just saying that there is such a degree of heterogeneity that you are now seeing, where for brands to provide a congruent, homogeneous, unified brand experience will become the key to success going forward. And I feel hyper-personalization is going to be the next big thing.
Very interesting. Yeah, with multiple platforms providing a homogeneous experience. Thanks. Prashant, concluding thoughts.
Yeah. No, so probably the only thing I would add is that, you know, Nitin, you touched upon this entire linkage, you know, from content to commerce. We've probably seen the beginning already of how these two streams are coming together, right? See, one thing which we often talk about the increase in clutter and the fragmentation, right? Honestly, what is also happening in this fragmentation is that there's a lot of democratization happening of what content I choose to consume, right? So there's no longer this, oh yeah, while there are properties like the IPL where, you know, everybody or a lot of people are watching them because there is still, you know, unification of interest when it comes and attention when it comes to say cricket or Bollywood in our country. There is now a lot of democratization on what content I want to consume. So I think one big trend which I see is brands, you know, now being, you know, more customer centric in terms of what content they enable, what content they produce, and not just say steal information or say steal attention when the customer was watching content of her choice, right? Through and just come in with an ad and say, hey, why don't you see my ad? Because I paid Star TV some money to show you my ad, right? So I think that's the big trend for me. And I kind of look forward to that becoming mainstream when it comes to how brands interact with customers.
Right. Very interesting. Thanks a lot. I think we are just about out of time. Vaibhav, I think over to you. I'm not sure we have, I think some of the panelists might have to leave. I'm not sure we have any time for questions, but thanks everyone. Great, great session.
Thanks.
Over to you.
Thank you so much, Nitin. I thoroughly enjoyed this session as someone who has been doing marketing related events all his adult life. And also now I've been doing and focusing a lot on my YouTube channel. I got to learn a lot, you know, how you guys are perceiving influencers and creators. So thanks a lot. I know that somebody has to leave, so please go ahead and feel free. But I have a few questions on creator economy and in terms of the play to earn games that are happening around. And I think I'm just going to ask you all one question. The social media now is moving on to a different realm. Right now, people are talking about decentralized social media. People are talking about platforms like BitCloud, platforms like Twitter is coming out with a platform called Blue Sky. I am associated with them in various ways. I'm working with them there on a different level. I would really like to take, you know, your take. Nitin, quickly, we'll start from you. You know, what is your take on decentralized social media and how is it going to impact the brands? I know it's great for the creators, but what about the brands?
You're wanting me to start?
Yeah, please.
Yes, I think somebody already said the biggest takeaway, right? Like for the brand to control the message that they are putting out in the context of decentralized social media, I think it's, on the one hand, the brand has to be where the conversation is and you got to have your message there. On the other hand, it's so fragmented with, you're going to be talking influencers in the dozens today. You're going to be talking influencers in the thousands, right? Especially when you go to tier 2, tier 3. It's an enormous challenge in terms of being able to both maintain a standardized communication, but also personalize to you know, the innumerable sort of segments and categories of customers that will be there. But yeah, I think the brands themselves should probably opine on this a little more.
Let's talk to Roshni about this. What's your take on the decentralized social media, and how is it going to affect brands?
Look, I always say the more places that the consumers can interact with you and buy from you, the better. Like I said, he talked about democratization of content. I would say democratization of choice. And, you know, to give you some stats, obviously social commerce today is about $1.5 billion. And then it's probably going to 16 billion to 20 billion. And this is all coming through smaller entrepreneurs. So great, a lot of women entrepreneurs out there selling through social commerce. And second is also, look at some of the boutiques that have begun to start on Instagram and then obviously connected to payment gateways and been able to derive a lot of economical value out of it. So I think good for brands to intercept with them where they are, and good for people who have the ability to therefore then craft micro enterprises and the entrepreneurship journey.
Thank you so much, Roshni, for that. Utsav, let me quickly move on to you. First thing, thank you for making the life easy of a lot of budding YouTubers. I know when I started my YouTube journey, the investment that we had to kind of contemplate, ki bhai ye kharidna hai, ye itne ka hai, and then suddenly you come out with such cost-effective and also very effectively, cameras and all of that. You know, what is your take and what is your understanding of where social media is headed via the decentralized social media, and how is it going to impact a brand like Noize?
So thanks, Vaibhav, for those kind words. But I think that was one of my concluding statements, that every single touch point is literally the moment of truth for the brand. Right? Because the fact is that as consumer-centric brands, you want to be controlling the narrative, but the reality is out there in the hands of these content creators and influencers who are driving that narrative for you. It's the last mile, really. And I think it's about time that brands wake up to the fact that the reality that people see is the perception, and driving and kind of curating that perception for the consumer is only going to stem out of authenticity. So for us as brands, I think all of that content is paramount, but what is more important is to be able to have an honest message about the solution that the brand is offering. And that is the key to my mind.
Thank you so much, Utsav. Prashant, quickly moving to you. First thing, thank you on behalf of all the creators for creating Creators Garage and the other stuff that you've been doing for creators. And I'm glad that you also mentioned about creator economy, because that's that's a buzzword right now. But then coming, over to creators and creator economy and the social tokens, you know, what is something that perhaps I think brands will now have to look a little differently, maybe because on a Facebook or on a Twitter, you know, you can pay in money and you can promote yourself. Roshni, thank you so much. I think I'm also done. I've been getting notes over here. So Prashant, I'm just going to just finish that question and say that how is it going to now change the world in ways that for a brand where you could just strategically put in money to promote, but now with decentralized, where there are no ads, where you can't really pay money to the platform because nobody really owns it and it is decentralized. How is that going to change your marketing perspective?
Yeah, no, great question. So I think a couple of things. One is that we will have to pivot to a content strategy which relies a lot more on multi-homing of content versus destination based content aggregation. So for example, if you take HP Creators Garage, I mean, it's more of a destination today for creators, right? And if there are multiple social platforms which kind of take off, then we'll have no other option but to, you know, make this content housed at multiple places and therefore rely much more on a distribution strategy versus a destination strategy when it comes to content, right? So I think that would be one way to be more relevant. It's very difficult, you know, to be honest, because it then means that you have to think again of content formats. You have to, you know, think again of delivery mechanisms. You do not have singular tracking of where the customer is, who's seen you, who's seen what, and so on. And therefore, the experience itself needs a lot more effort to kind of, you know, curate. But yeah, that's what we'll have to find answers to.
Thank you so much, Prashant.
We'll have more people in the marketing teams and more marketing agencies around, I guess.
Probably all we'll find robots to, you know, and to do that job for us, yeah.
Super. Suraj, I'm sorry, we are running out of time, but I just want to say thank you. I think for a lot of us, I was just chatting on the group with the team of BW Business World and Exchange for Media. I think a couple of us had the first laptop of Acer. So thank you. Continue to keep inspiring all the young guys out there. And thank you, Nitin. I would love to get in touch with Nitin after this. You know, I would love to understand more on the survey that he's done for influencers. I would love to get that data, and I would love to learn more and how I can better my content.
Thanks, everyone.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thanks for having me.